Hello everybody, this is Havoc and welcome to the first video in a series of videos on Total War Rome Remastered. This is a guide for what I'm going to dub Total War Beginners. This is designed for people who have maybe never tried Rome Total War, be it you got in later in the series or you've just never heard of it, or even for those who maybe want to check the game out before they decide to purchase it, since this will come out before release. Regardless, I hope everyone gleans something from this, and the goal is to just basically lay everything out without going super hardcore into like the code or the meta or, you know, build this at turn one, turn around and do this at turn four kind of a deal. This is basically just going over the mechanics of everything because there is a lot to consider with this game. Kind of forgot about it, to be completely honest. So what we're going to do today in this first video is probably not even going to get to the campaign map. We may hit start your campaign at the very end because there are a lot of settings that we have to consider that aren't super micro settings, but are still relevant to your campaign. And if you hear any pauses, it's because I have a cough or I'm clearing my throat doing something that's not appropriate to be recording, so I've muted myself out. So what we're going to do today, like I said, we're going to go over the settings. I'm going to show you how to set up your campaign for beginners, so you can kind of gauge where you need to start at. So we are going to start right over here in settings, and we're going to start with graphics settings. Now, again, I'm not going to go into all the fine details of your graphic settings, like, you know, anti-aliasing or your water quality, sky quality, unit quality. That is up to you and your computer. You decide what you want to do. I'm sure there will be a guide for something like that, but for beginnings, especially for beginners, I don't want to overwhelm you with a whole bunch of different statistical type of things. But what we are going to do is look at things that do have an effect on how your campaign looks or how your campaign feels to a degree. So for instance, my quality is custom, and we'll get into the fine details of that. I am rocking at 1440p, just so you know, borderless window, because I don't want to play at a full screen 4K. Although it is completely and totally doable. We have unit color scheme. So realistic is the remastered version. Vibrant is obviously the original version, as it says in those parentheses. Vibrant, if you've played Rome Total War, you'll have your pajama pant Persians spearmen, with that's like the ultra bright pink kind of suits. Super, super red for the Julii, super green, you know, that kind of a deal. Or you can go the more realistic, where the colors are a bit more muted, they're a bit more, well, realistic. So we're gonna go with realistic because I like that color scheme a lot better. This is brand new, and it's not necessarily just because of me, it is because of you guys who have said, man, this feels too vibrant, I don't like it. Now, the developers did say that they saw that video and they saw those comments and where I address it, and they were actually able to add it in without too much difficulty. So if you'll notice, it is default at 100%. Everything that you've seen before this video will indeed be at that 100% vibrancy. I knocked it down to 70% yesterday when I was messing around with things, and that is still not even quite enough. So we are going to try and see what 40% looks like, and you'll see kind of a gauge of what that will do. Your other settings here are the brightness. This is the brightness, the light exposure. We're keeping that at 100%. Gamma optimizes contrast and brightness for your monitors. Unit UI size, it is going to work on 1440p. We can always go back into the settings and increase that if we want to, but I'm keeping it at UI size 100% because it scales for resolution at 100% as well. And then if you wanted to, you could limit your frame rate. I'm not going to limit my frame rate. I don't mind seeing those big fluctuations, but if you're more of a person that, you know, well, I don't need to see anything beyond 60 FPS, then you can limit it to 60 FPS. Now we are going to go into the advanced graphic menu. This is that level of detail, shadows, all that stuff that I told you about that I'm not going to worry about in this video because it's, again, all up to what you really, really, really want to see, and also what your computer can handle. Something like vibrancy can handle no matter what your computer looks like. That's not the kind of detail that I'm talking about This is, like I said, your texture filtering, your depth of field, your terrain detail, all that kind of stuff. You can see what I'm rocking, and what I'm rocking right now levels out at about 150 to 170 FPS on the campaign map, and then averaging somewhere between 80 to 100 FPS on battles. All of these settings, that's what that brings. So you can pause the video, you can check it out yourself, or you can do whatever in the heck you want. Now, for complete beginners, if you are new to Total War, this is going to be a pretty important thing to consider is your unit scale. Low is obviously this very, very small. So even your 20 versus 20 stack units are not going to be very big, whereas your extreme are very, very, very big. What you want to do if you're wanting to go big or go home is go on Ultra if you want a balanced campaign experience. And the reason being, Ultra is the largest unit size from the original game. It does say, hey, by the way, your performance may be affected. I haven't seen any performance hits that's so drastic where you wouldn't want that big one unless you just don't want large units in your battles from the get-go. Now, you saw Extreme here. It is experimental. I'm not sure if they are going to end up balancing it and fix unit pathing or anything like that. Extreme is meant just to have fun. So you will get those battles that don't make sense. You will get units that don't respond on Extreme. Ultra is going to be the largest you want to go for without actually having some balance issues per se. This is going to work in your cities. It's going to work on the battlefield. It's going to be more responsive. So if you want that, Ultra is your biggest, but of course you can always set it to any lower, and you can even play with Extreme. It just know that you're not going to get the best experience out of it. So we've got all of our stuff here. We've got all of our things here. Oh, map vibrancy. We're going to turn that back down to 40. I didn't hit confirm is the dealio. So we're going to hit confirm, and that should be good. Audio settings, we don't need to worry about. Control settings, you can look and see what that does for you. Now, reminding you that this is the remastered version that we are going to be working with. Your camera controls and your movement and all that stuff will be on the new system of the newer Total Wars, WASD, control click, all that kind of deal. So keep that in mind. And you can see modern Total War there. What's going to be more important is your gameplay settings. Now, by default, this goes towards an unlocked camera. You can restrict it to your army, which means you couldn't go beyond a certain distance beyond your army. You can even lock it to your general for an ultra ridiculous experience. We're keeping it at unlocked so you can look across the entire map. You want the remastered camera, like I just explained. The gameplay right here is what's really important for your battles specifically. The tactical map transition means that if I scroll out far enough, I will get a bar at the top of my screen that says, hey, by the way, you're about to transition into the tactical map. We want that there, so in case you accidentally scroll too much, you have that. The same for the map overlay on the campaign map. It works exactly the same. You do want tooltips on. This is going to be very important, especially as a beginner, for the campaign map and your battles. Now, what you don't have to do is you don't have to display missile trails. It does look a bit crazy, a bit ridiculous, but it allows you to see where your units are shooting. So if that's important to you, and as a beginner, I feel like that would be a pretty important thing to have. You could totally have that on. I don't need to worry about it. And then you can pan your camera with the mouse cursor, which means if you move your cursor to the edge of the screen there, you will be able to pan the camera that way. I hate that as a streamer and as a content creator. It's very, very annoying to have that happen, so I keep it off. All right, so that pretty much explains everything in the settings that we need to worry about. What we're going to do now is we are going to go into a new game under Imperial Campaign. And this is going to bring up your faction selection screen. Now, as you can see here, we default to the Julii. And if you are brand new to the game and you just open it up the first time, if you haven't unlocked all factions by going into the specific tab to unlock it all, you will notice that you will only have three factions. You'll have the Julii, the Brutii, and the Scipii. These are your starting three, and the real honest way to unlock all of these factions is to conquer them. So if we were to conquer the Gauls first, we would be able to then turn around and start a new campaign as the Gauls if we were to conquer the Scythians or the Scythians first, you know, kind of that deal. So this is your faction selection screen. You'll notice that if we select any of these, it doesn't really give us any of the newer things like faction traits or anything like that. Instead, it'll just say, hey, these are good spearmen and foot archers along with swift cav and chariots, or strong close combat infantry but very limited cav. And as you can see, as we click, it will show you the different territories. So this is a little bit important. If you want to, you can totally play as all these. It gives you a faction difficulty of how they think it should go. We are going to stick with the Julii because it's going to make the most sense. It's the one that I personally played the most, and it's going to give you the best opportunity to succeed in understanding the mechanics of the game. Now, we are not done. We're not just going to hit start campaign. There's a lot we have to consider. We are not going to enable the tutorial because I am the tutorial. But we do see here we can, the goal is to become the supreme ruler of Rome and control at least 50 provinces. And we'll get into provinces and what that means and what it means to become the supreme ruler of Rome as well. Now your advice level, we aren't going to do any advice level. You totally can do high for your first time. The tutorials and the advice levels are really, really good. So if you want to do that, you totally can. No issues with that whatsoever. But hopefully I am going to be a good enough tutorial if you're watching this video. So we're not going to do any advice level. The campaign difficulty, we don't have a confirmation because it is a little more abstract. And to be honest, Feral doesn't want to give away the like meta of it all, which is fair. But from what I've heard with the original game is that on easy, your own faction received melee attack and morale. I guess this is more for battles. Received melee attack and morale boosts for battles. On medium, and the AI was really, really dumb. On medium, there are no advantages and no disadvantages on battles. On hard, the AI, your other factions that are you're not playing as, will get buffs to their morale and attack, as well as making smarter battle tactics. And on very hard, they get really, really good. They start taking the high ground. They start doing some more advanced kind of deals, retreating, moving around, flanking you, etc., etc. So for me, hard is going to be good enough for me. For you, it doesn't really matter. I'm not going to judge anything that you choose to do. On the campaign side, we know that the AI gets economic buffs, be it more starting money per turn. We get starting money per turn, just to give you a heads up. But they get more. They probably don't have to pay as much in upkeep. Their buildings may do a little bit better. Their trade may be more advantageous. And as we get along, that only gets higher and higher. But on top of that, as you ramp up your campaign difficulty, the AI is actually going to make smarter and smarter moves. It's no longer going to be, hey, give me, you know, I don't know, give me trade rights if you pay me 15,000 gold. It's going to be, hey, we see that we're losing. We are going to offer peace sooner. Or, hey, we can press this attack. We know what we're doing a little bit better. From what I've seen and what I've read, the AI starts just getting smarter and smarter as the difficulty goes up, along with those economic battle buffs. So it doesn't matter what you want to do. You can do any of these. You can do very hard if you want to, or you can slip it down to easy and just have some fun with it for your first time. It's completely, completely up to you. These down here are pretty important. They're kind of just more quality of life to your campaign. You have arcade battles, which are quicker and less realistic, which means that morale fatigue and some abilities are disabled and ammunition is unlimited. This is for, again, more arcadey battles, less realistic. You aren't going to have to worry about keeping your troops still for a little bit to catch their breath. They don't route based on morale. It's just a fun setting to do it in. I personally don't like it, but some people do. It's up to you completely. You can do a campaign with it, see how you like it, or otherwise. I'm going to take a quick drink real quick. Next up is realistic governance. Now, in this game, you can have realistic governance on, which means that you have to have an actual character of your family inside of a city in order to take control of it. And by that, I mean in order for you to build units, auto-manage taxes, build units, etc., etc. You have to have a governor in there to do it. Now, if you have it turned off, obviously you can manage everything. So it's up to you. This creates just kind of an incentive to keep characters in cities. There's more benefits to that, but it's whatever you want to do here. I tend to keep it off because I do like to be in control of my cities, and I don't really trust the AI to make the right move. We have no battle time limit. That's pretty obvious. It removes the time limit. So that way, if you just want to focus on doing it slow and not worrying about surviving or taking out any kind of time-specific requirements. I never have that on because sometimes I play the kite game or the cheese game where the only way I survive a battle is by the time limit. This is probably one of the most important things to have unselected in your campaign. You don't want to follow characters in Rome 1. It's a frustrating business, I'll just say that. A frustrating venture, rather. The AI takes smaller steps. You can't adjust how quickly they move. Well, you can to an extent, but it doesn't do like the skip ahead. You can't partially follow them. It simply follows every single character that you can see on your map. So I do this. It takes the intern times from, you know, a couple few minutes because you're watching everyone down to literally, you know, 10 or 15 seconds per turn, which is amazing, which is really, really awesome. And then if we wanted to, and if you want to as well, you can do a short campaign. The short campaign, as you can see, changes the top here. Instead of the Supreme Ruler of Rome and 15 provinces, it is hold 15 provinces and destroy or outlast the following faction or factions, Gaul. So we'd only have to own 15 and we'd have to take out the Gauls. That's all you gotta do. This is for people who maybe want to complete a campaign in one sitting, or they're going for a specific achievement, or they're just doing a hot seat campaign. There's plenty of reasons to do it, and if you want to do it that way as well, just to kind of get your feet wet, that's 100% all right for you as well. We are not going to do that. Now, you can read the faction overview. That's fine. It just basically tells you a little bit about the faction you're going after. But before we hit start campaign, I told you we probably will not get to this today. In fact, I can guarantee you we won't, because it doesn't make sense to partially get into the campaign and cut you off after a few minutes. But what we are going to do is we are going to go into the modifiers right before we do this. Now, as you can see here, the modifiers have a whole bunch of areas that are being modified. Obviously. Now there's two sides to this. There is the classic and there is the remastered. A few things have been added here, such as population cost balancing, and I believe campaign actually has been improved as well. Either that or AI improvement. I can't remember. There's been a couple that were updated literally this morning that I'm doing it. So what you do here is you can pick and choose between what you want to have in your Imperial campaign. You can see here right now we have remastered everything, and it's going to tell you what the remastered does. If we hover over it, over there on the right side, you can see what the differences are. So for instance, in battles, in the original game, you don't have night battles in the original base Total War Rome. And rain doesn't affect flaming projectiles. If we were to do the mastered or the remastered, night battles are available. Flaming projectiles are less effective in rain. Logic for reinforcements has been adjusted, and balance and auto resolve has been improved. It's the same across the board. If we were to click this, you can see we will behave identical to the original game. I don't know why you'd really do anything in the classic unless you're just dying to play 4K Rome 1 for kicks and giggles. Pretty much in every area here, the remastered version is going to be better. In the campaign, you can see it adds a whole bunch of things. A whole lot of things get remastered. And the population cost. In the original, the population cost varies based on the unit size graphics. It is tied to the actual headcount. In the remaster, the population cost of recruitment is normalized across all sizes, recruiting at unit cost as many soldiers would be a headcount on normal. So this is the only area in which I would probably not do remastered or where I had conflicts. So basically your population cost balancing in the classic, if your units take 200 soldiers or 200 population, in the original, every time you recruited a unit, you would get 200 units or 200 population taken out of your cities. What happened then was that you would get to the late game because you know how to play the game, but the AI would be so focused on recruiting so many people that you would never see enemy AI late game units. So you'd be able to steamroll because everyone is too busy doing their other stuff. In the remastered, even if you are at ultra unit size graphics, you are going to recruit soldiers on the normal unit size factor. So if a ultra unit size is 200 units, but the normal unit size is, I don't know, say 100 units, then every time you recruit a unit, even when you're on ultra, you're only taking out 100 population. That encourages the AI, it kind of balances their population growth, so that way you can see later era units in the game. So it's up to you if you want to do that. I'm a little bit conflicted here because I don't necessarily agree with the remastered. I understand the logic. I don't necessarily agree with it because it does kind of suck, but I understand why they did that. So we are going to keep remastered just for you to have a better experience of a late game. We won't get to the late game, but it'll at least get you up on your feet. The intern mechanics, much faster, and the intern for the remaster does gives you, hey, by the way, you have some things you haven't checked out yet. You should probably check these out. Diplomacy, it allows for the things such as canceling treaties or canceling embargo trade routes is a big deal. And then for this, merchants and trade, merchants weren't in Rome 1 remaster. They weren't in the original, excuse me. Merchants are in Total War Rome Remastered, and we'll get to all of those. So again, population cost balancing is probably the only one I would have a conflict with, but outside of that, we're just going to stick with the remastered version completely. Now, it's up to you how you want to do that. It's up to you on who to choose, but we are again going to play with Julii, highly trained infantry and supporting ox troops, but limited cavalry. That is going to be the same across the board, but this allows us to immediately advance on land to go north and have a very identifiable enemy that is relatively easy to fight against. So we are going to hit start campaign, but I must warn you, we will end right as soon as we get into it. I just want you to see what it's like. I still don't know if I can show the intro video, so I am going to cut across that. And then depending on your computer, depends on how quickly you upload the campaign. This is obviously in real time, and it usually doesn't even take this long for me, which is really interesting. It's going to give you some tips, it's going to give you some quotes, it's going to let you know who you are playing as and the date they're in. And then welcome to your trade or your campaign map. Now, as you notice, this is at 40% saturation. So keep that in mind when you're doing things. So it'd be really interesting to see. It's still very colorful compared to the original, but I like how it has been dulled down. So I think 40% is pretty fair. You may even be able to toggle it down to 30% before it just gets really too unsaturated. But ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be your campaign map for the next episode. We're going to roll right into it. We're going to start right where we left off. I'm going to go grab a cup of tea and kind of soothe my throat for a little bit before we get back into it. But we're going to go over your diplomats, your settlements, your army movement, your user interface, and all of the things that you have set up in your campaign. We're going to walk through. It's going to be pretty detailed. Odds are we won't even hit the third or fourth episode before we hit the intern button. Keep that in mind. There's a lot to go over. I hope I'm not overwhelming you, but I do hope you have enjoyed it. So if you did, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Leave any comments or questions in the comment section down below where myself or maybe one of the developers or even other members of the community can come help you out. Guys, I really do hope you enjoyed this. This is way beyond my usual thing to do. If you did enjoy it, be sure to also subscribe to the channel and check out my Twitch where I will be streaming this game as well. All those links will be in the description. You can pre-purchase this game and or purchase it on my Nexus GG store, which is another link you will find in there. It supports this channel directly. So if you really did appreciate the tutorial series, that is one of the best ways that you could show your support. Thank you so much, guys, for hanging around here for this less than 30-minute first episode. Sorry we didn't get into the main campaign stuff, but we'll get into it in this next episode. This is Havoc, and I will see you in the next video.